Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. If no one has said it yet to you this morning, Happy New Year. Today is the first Sunday of the church's year, the first Sunday of Advent. This is the season where we prepare our hearts and minds, not only for Christmas by getting our homes ready and those things, but more importantly, for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is the season where we tend to our hearts and to our minds so that when Christ returns, we will be ready. We pray that our worship this morning will help us into this season and help us prepare for Christ's coming. Our guest preacher this morning is no stranger to this place. Bishop Will Willimon, who was the former dean of the chapel, is our guest preacher. You will know him not only because he's preached here so many times before, but also because he and his wife Patsy worship regularly here. We are so glad to have you here bringing us the word of the Lord this morning, Will. Also, our guest choir this morning is no stranger to this place. The cantabile singers of the Capital City Girls Choir are back here with us again. They've already blessed us with their music this morning. Let's go ahead and give them a hand. We thank you for traveling here and leading us in worship. As always, you will find some announcements in your bulletin for ways to engage your heart and mind and hands in the work of worship throughout the week. I want to point out that this Thursday evening, our Vesper service is our Advent Lessons and Carol service, and we invite you to come and be present and participate in that service. As we watch and wait for the coming of our Lord, let us stand to worship God together.
We have sung, "Sin's dreadful doom upon us lies." As we prepare for the coming of Christ, we cannot help but recognize our failings, both for us individually and for us as a church. During this Advent season, we will be using a short litany of confession marked by the familiar phrase, "Come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free." Your responses are printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. O God, you search us out and know us, and all that we are is open to you. We confess that we have sinned. Come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. When we scoff at those who await your return and live as though you were never here, come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. When we long for your coming to change the world, and yet are unwilling to allow our hearts to be changed, come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. When we do not make straight paths for justice, nor offer a welcome when you come as a stranger, come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. When we dismiss prophets and heavenly messengers and refuse to nourish your seed within us, come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. When we reduce our preparation for your coming to reckless expense and trivialities, come, thou long-expected Jesus, set thy people free. We turn to you, O God of infinite mercy. We renounce our evil. We claim your love. Make us whole. Come, thou long-expected Jesus. Set thy people free. According to the prophet Jeremiah, the Lord says, "The days are surely coming when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Salvation and safety are coming, for the Lord is righteous." As disciples of Jesus Christ, we know God's promise is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Salvation is here. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As God's forgiven people who know the peace of Christ, let us now share that peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Almighty God, as your kingdom dawns and as we hear your word, turn us from the darkness of sin to the light of holiness, that we may be ready to meet you in the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter. "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks. The New Testament lesson is from 1 Thessalonians, the third chapter. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 21st chapter. Jesus said, "There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads because your redemption is drawing near." Then he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on your guard, so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the word of the Lord.
There will be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, the roaring of the seas and the waves, the heavens shaken. There will be distress among the nations. And the Son of Man descending on a cloud with power and great glory. Many will faint from fear. The things taking place. But when these things happen, stand up, lift up your eyes, your redemption is drawing near. It's the first Sunday of Advent, and on the first Sunday of Advent, Jesus always gets weird. And not simply because he talks in dark, apocalyptic portents and sea and sky, but also because Jesus talks redemption. To people who may not be that sure, we need redeeming. How do you like it when Jesus gets apocalyptic redemptive? Flannery O'Connor, the last great Catholic theologian, said famously, one of her anti-preachers, Hazel Motes, says, "Any man with a good car don't need redemption." Which suggests to me that whether or not you like the Advent scripture may be predicated on the cost of the car that brought you here this morning. Jesus goes apocalyptic, redemptive. My very first Sunday in the pulpit of Duke Chapel, June 1984, and Durham was doing its usual nosedive into drought and turning West Campus into the Sahara. So during the prayer for others, I prayed for rain. Lord, please send us rain. We need rain. We promise to be good all year long. Send us rain. Well, after the service, this distinguished Duke professor swaggered up to me and said, "Praying for rain? What is this?" And then he said, "Duke Chapel is a sophisticated, thoughtful university church. Praying for rain?" The next Sunday, Jesus fed a multitude of hungry people with just a few loaves and fish. And I preached on it as well as I knew how. Well, after the service, this sophomore comes up to me and says, "How in the heck can you preach for 20 minutes on world hunger and not mention our duty to get organized and stop world hunger?" A sophomore calling me irresponsible. Well, I said, "Hey, kid, if you know how to stop world hunger, what are you doing wasting time here in church? Get on with it." Thus, I was unsurprised a couple years later when I put out a questionnaire. I asked you, "What do you expect from sermons in Duke Chapel?" And one of the predominant responses was, "I want a sermon that reminds me of my responsibilities and motivates me to do my responsibility, to fulfill my responsibilities, to reach out to those in need." Okay, you ask for it. I want you to write this down. Get out one of those little tiny golf pencils they got in the back of the pews. Write this down. Okay, church, this week, I want you to work on your sexism, racism, classism, ageism, ethnocentrism. Stop using styrofoam. Go vegan, gluten-free, eat locally, think globally. If you want peace, work for justice, fight against gentrification. Don't drink so much. Don't give so little. Practice civility, mindfulness, inclusiveness. Take precautions on dates. Keep Sabbath, breathe deeply. Live simply, practice diversity. Perform random acts of kindness. Pay it forward. You drink too much. Don't you give me that look when I'm up here doing my Methodist moralizing on you. Do a good deed daily. Love your neighbor as yourself. It's up to you to do right, or right won't be done. You're the hope of tomorrow. You can do anything you set your mind to. You drink too much. Do you notice anything missing? God. Come back next Sunday. You'll be given another list. You are responsible, sensitive, caring people, compassionate, liberal, open-minded, culturally diverse, gluten-free, mindful people who have your master's degree. Otherwise, you wouldn't be coming to this church. Christianity, therefore, is a kind of primitive technique of motivating responsible people like us to save ourselves by ourselves. That's why I, as a professional theologian, label most of you as Pelagians. It takes one to know one. You can Wikipedia Pelagianism when I'm done with you. Well, Pelagians are good people who are making progress. And we come to church not for world-shaking, heavens-rending redemption. We come for some fine moral tuning, a spiritual boost. Not the Son of Man rending the heavens and coming down on clouds with glory and power. Not God-wrought redemption. Well, sorry, it's the first Sunday of Advent. Did you notice? None of today's scripture is about you. There is absolutely nothing in any of the lessons for you to think or do or feel. And I know that makes people like us nervous. Advent makes nervous Pelagians with advanced degrees who drive Volvos and shop at Whole Foods and eat kale. Well, relax. There's a good chance that the Advent scriptures may not even be for us. Advent, I think, is probably for other people. People who maybe wouldn't be comfortable at our gathering. People who find the economic, political deck stacked against them. People who don't even own the boots to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. People who've got no hope but God. Now, we Pelagians, we live by the officially sanctioned, governmentally subsidized narrative. You know that how we got our lives together and we finally saw the light and we got organized and we got ourselves to church and we overcame our biases and we gave up our bad habits and we got back to God. But Advent tells a counter story, a story that you cannot tell yourself, a story that is not allowed to be told anywhere else in this university. No, you had to get dressed and come down here to this weird building at an inconvenient hour of the week to hear this story. It's an odd, un-American tale of God's rending the heavens and God stooping down to people that time and again have shown we cannot heft ourselves up to God. That story. I trusted you. You said you were making progress. You said that you were getting a handle on your destructive habits. And then, a couple of Advents ago, you snuck into a little booth and pulled the curtain behind you. And when nobody was looking, you voted for a prevaricating, misogynist, casino-owning... I don't think I'll ever be able to trust you with the fate of the entire world in your hands again. Oh, we've got good intentions. We get organized, we take action, and we vote, we send troops to the border to protect us against pregnant women and their children, and just happen to end up putting more of our fellow citizens in jail than any country in the world. We wanted security for our families and somehow ended up getting the most violent streets. We wanted privacy and got loneliness. We wanted freedom more than anything, and we unintentionally enshrined vast economic inequality. Just last week, I heard that the lifespan of Americans for the first time in decades is shortening due to the opioid epidemic. It does something to you to know that vast numbers of our fellow citizens would rather do slow suicide than live with us. In other words, we are, despite any of our pretensions, just the sort of people who, when the sky turned dark one Friday afternoon, church and state at last cooperating together, power to the people, democracy in action. We got organized and we stood up to make Judea great again, and we just happened to torture to death the Son of God on a cross. A sermon is not about you. A sermon's about God. And that wonderful moment when we open the scriptures and we dare to allow Jesus to talk weird to us. And we pray for the guts to risk potentially disruptive, redemptive questions like, what time is it? Are we at an ending or are we at a beginning? But more importantly, who is God? And what is God up to? And how can we, even we in our ineptitude, how can we hitch on to what God is up to now? You said you sincerely crave my sanctimonious Methodist moralism, how you could set yourself right, how you could get your social attitudes all cleaned up. Did you know all of this morning's scripture has a theme? At least that of Jeremiah and Jesus. And it is, the theme is simply, hey people, God is coming. Or as we say it in church speak, Advent. Though time and again we have shown our utter inability to climb up to God, the good news, God in Jesus Christ is climbing down to us. Oh, the modern world, thank you, Voltaire, Bacon, Locke. The modern world found it really couldn't get going until it did something about an interventionist, active God. And so we had to render God into a little godlet that is allegedly caring and compassionate, but never actually gets around to doing anything. We had to rob God of God's agency so we could get enough room for our Promethean human agency. Well, all of this morning's scripture says in different ways, we have a relentlessly redemptive God who refuses to leave things up to us. Jeremiah says, okay, I've had enough of you trying to do politics. Now I'm going to send you a new King of David, president, and he's going to execute justice, and he's going to execute righteousness, whether you like it or not. And then Jesus talks about the weather changing and dark changes in the sky and the sea and the waves and the great nations trembling in distress and your redemption drawing near. Is that good news or bad? I guess that depends somewhat on where you happen to be when you get the news. Where does this Advent find you? Or maybe it's good news or bad on the basis of how nervous you get at the possibility that God is not only love, but love in action. And that God shall not be defeated to get God's purposes for the world. When I was bishop in Bama, I tried to lead the church in confronting our sins of racism. And I remember one night in a church basement, we were in a discussion, and an older African-American woman said to me, Bishop, how I wish your good intentions could exorcise this demon. But let me tell you, we've been waiting for y'all to do right for a long time. I just don't think this sin is going to be fixed by you. If there's not a redemptive God who loves to save sinners, I think your people are doomed. Well, this morning we're betting our lives that this morning's scripture is not only weird, it just happens to be true. Signs in the moon and the sun and the stars and the roaring of waves and the shaking of the nations the Son of Man coming in clouds, our redemption drawing near. You know, the highlight of worship in my 1,000 Sundays here in Duke Chapel, the highlight for me was being up here and watching you during communion or the Eucharist. And I watched you come down that aisle, and I watched you with all that you know and with your master's degree and with all that you're good at, and but I watched you would come down that aisle and hold out empty hands. You, in spite of all your achievements, you were empty, receptive. You look like a child, like a beggar, like you just couldn't go on unless you received a gift that you could do nothing to earn. You, the body and blood, the presence of a living God. That, for me, was as good as it gets in this church. That was you at your most truthful. God at God's most redemptive. Hey, it's Advent. Keep your eye on the sky. It could be a change in the weather. Like it or not, your redemption.
We confess the Apostles' Creed because in Christ's coming, God has disrupted all the other creeds by which we try to live. So let us stand together to confess our faith in the words of the Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. We come to you, saving Lord, with empty hands, holding them out in need of your world-changing, life-rearranging, disruptive grace. Remind us again of your coming. Remind us again to watch and wait for your inbreaking kingdom. We look to you to supply our every need. We come to you as those who find the political, economic, and social deck stacked for us, and as those who have that same deck stacked against us. And we all need you just the same. We turn even now to you, Lord, for rain, for bread, for peace, for healing, for hope, asking that you redeem the worst of times into your good time. Lord, in your mercy, justifying God, you do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. You alone have the power to redeem your fallen world and your broken people. Move where only you can move, and work in ways only you can. You know intimately the brokenness of our world. Interrupt the violence that we've come to accept as normal, and the violence we've built into our systems of organizing our lives together. Shake the powers of heavens and our systems. We hold to your care Samuel, Julia, and Daniel, and all those families who've been harmed by our broken immigration system. Walk with all who are seeking refuge or asylum today. We pray with Jeremiah that you would execute justice and righteousness in our land. Replace hate, inequity, and harm with your love, your justice, with joy and peace. Lord, in your mercy. Atoning Lord, you are the hope of the whole world, and we remember today that you are our only hope. Humble us when we start believing life is all about us and about how we think or feel or what we do. Draw near to all who are lonely or lost or afraid today. Cherish any for whom the holiday season is filled with sadness because of lost loved ones or broken relationships. We lift to you especially families who've lost loved ones to acts of violence. Bathe them in your comforting grace. Embrace any who are struggling with long-term illness today. Strengthen and renew caretakers, and protect them from a spirit of bitterness or despair even when healing comes. Today, we remember those within our community and around the world who are suffering from HIV/AIDS. Continue to open means for healing, especially among people without financial resources. Lord, in your mercy, in the strength of your Spirit, Lord, increase more and more your love in us, for one another and for all people. Strengthen us in holiness, that we might be ready when that day comes to see you face to face, our Lord of glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All cash offerings and checks written to Duke University Chapel today will go to support the Pathways program, the chapel's student ministry. Because God gave everything to us, by giving God's self, we also give today. May we give all of who we are, our whole selves, even as we give our offerings.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you and give you thanks that you are God alone. You do what we cannot do. You love deeply and sacrificially. You forgive generously. And you come to redeem us whether we like it or not, whether we admit we need it or not. We are grateful for the many ways you break into our lives and our world, and for the promise that you are not done with us yet. Take now, we pray, our lives and our offerings, and use them according to your will. These things we pray in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go now in anticipation, ready to be redeemed, looking to the skies, for Jesus is coming. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.